Friends, what a wonderful opportunity God has given for you to study the Word of God. I know you are busy with your worldly activities and your official work, but God has given you little time to sit in His presence. So before we start studying the Word of God, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you, we thank you for giving us this opportunity to study your Word. Lord, help us to understand your Word through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher. Teach us this time. In the name of Jesus Christ, I come against every wicked spirit that hinders the minds and the hearts of our friends from knowing the Word. I command these spirits to be out, and I loose their hearts to understand the Word of God. The CD player or the television set or whatever it be, I pray that it be covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. The whole area be controlled by the presence of God. Father, let your name be glorified. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Let this be your desire to have more of Jesus. We have been studying about victorious Christian life in continuation of that series. We are studying how to overcome the flesh. And in the other cassette you heard, the other CD you heard about taking the yoke of Jesus Christ. And I explained the yoke we find in Matthew chapter 5, 6 and 7. And I explained about it. Now, in continuation of the yoke, the other component of the yoke, we find in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. In continuation of the yoke, this is not a separate one, but the other component of the yoke we find in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. I'd like to show you, see, straight. Here in the Word of God, it says straight. Straight gate, the meaning is, in Greek, it is stenos. Stenos means, on that door, there are so many obstacles standing close. That is, as a small door, there are obstacles up and down and left and right. You cannot go easily. That you mean by straight gate. There are doors or gates which wide open. There is explained about two gates. One is the broad gate, large, very, see, the wide gate and the broad way. Then there is a straight gate, the narrow way. The straight means the way, the gate itself, though it is very, very small, yet there are obstacles. The word stenos means that on the way of that door, of that gate, there are obstacles. Something is protruding here and there so that you cannot just go in like that. You'll have to bend yourself. You have to adjust yourself according. Then only you can get in there. Then the narrow means tlibo. Tlibo means afflicted, hurt. When you walk in that way, you will get afflicted. Narrow means tlibo. Tlibo means when you walk on that way, you get afflicted. So friend, the other component of this yoke of Christ is choosing the straight gate and narrow way. There are so many options before a child of God. He can walk through a broad way, getting all comfort of this world, broad gate and wide gate, and walk through the broad way. But the end will be destruction. Why? The flesh, which always after enjoying things of the world, will take you out of the way, and finally you will end up in the lake of fire. Because of your flesh, friend, Jesus spoke to you. Jesus tells us, Jesus teaches us that we choose the straight gate. The straight gate means you cannot go as you are. You had to bend. There are some obstacles at that gate itself. Unless you bend and adjust your body to kneel down, you may have to kneel down, you may have to bow down, then only you will be able to enter into that straight gate. That's why the word stenos means some obstacles are there. So some obstacles, the straight, remember, the straight is there are some obstacles. When you try to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, there will be some obstacles. It is not easy to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Because when you come to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, obstacles will be there from your family, from your father, from your mother, from your wife, and from your children, from your relatives. And physically there will be some obstacles. So many things. So it is not well accepted wide gate. It's a straight gate. So when you prepare yourself to go through the straight gate, your flesh in you will cry and say, no, 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 this is not the way. Because the flesh in you will never agree the path of suffering. The flesh always wants to enjoy, make yourself comfortable, happy, and life of luxury. So the way for a person who wants to enter into eternal life, he must choose the straight gate. See, some people think that I've accepted Jesus Christ, I'm taken water baptism, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, I am already entered through the straight gate. No, my dear brother, you may be a pastor, you may be a preacher, you may be a great evangelist healing many people, but still you may be outside the gate. God brought you to the way of experience of salvation and water baptism and of the Holy Spirit. And God has given you the gift of healing and so many things. But yet, for your own eternal life, my friend, you will have to choose the straight gate. These days, many servants of God think that when I start the ministry in the beginning, it will be a lot of suffering, lot of problem, lot of difficulties. And then after I suffer for a while, God will begin to bless me materially. And then I will have many material things and I'll grow up. You know, I want you to turn your attention to Paul. Paul speaks about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Paul speaks about 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9 to 13. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9 to 13. Even unto this present hour we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted and have no sweat and dwelling place. See, he is the apostle. So many think that when we start in the ministry, in the beginning there will be troubles, hardship. But as you grow in the ministry, there will be plenty of things. My dear friend, that is the experience of a servant of God who has chosen the wide gate and walking through the broad way. But for a child of God who knows about the mystery of the flesh, that dwells in him will choose that straight gate. Means entering through the straight gates is not easy. It is painful. And then the way is also narrow. The narrow, I already explained to you, thlipo. Thlipo means when you walk on that narrow way, you will get afflicted. You will get wounded. You'll get painful. Means there are some ways which are full of good roads and bed of roses. But The path of a true believer is a path of thorns. When you walk through the thorns, certainly you will get hurt. Many people do not know this mystery. Friend, why God wants you to choose the straight gate and the narrow way? The reason for it, your flesh is restricted. Your flesh is controlled. The flesh is not allowed to choose his own way to make life more comfortable. If you allow your flesh to have a comfortable life, then definitely it will take to hellfire. For your salvation, you need not walk through the narrow gate. For your salvation, you need not enter through the straight gate. According to the Eastern religions and some religions of the world, they teach people to penalize their own body, to penalize themselves so that you may get salvation. They tell people to walk on their knees. They tell people to walk on the their knees, and sometimes people just crawl to reach that place. That means they are penalizing, they are punishing their own body to get salvation. That is not the way of God. God himself took the suffering. I have seen some people in India, sadhus in India, they make a slipper with full of nails. The nails, the sharp point of the nails will be upward. Their feet will be on the nails. That means whenever they walk, that pointed nails goes inside their feet. So they get pain. They are paying that price so that they may be able to overcome sin. That is not the way. Some people stand on one leg and keep on fasting so that they can penalize for their sins. That is not the way. Jesus Christ took all that punishment for you and for me, for all our past sins, all the sins that have come through Adam and Eve. Jesus Christ has paid the price on the cross of Calvary. But now you have a flesh. And that flesh is a luxury enjoying flesh. The flesh is always after comfortable things. The flesh is always after easy things. And if you allow your flesh to have an easy life, a free way, my dear friend, remember that you will certainly end up in great trouble. You go into destruction. But if you choose the narrow way, and if you choose the straight gate, your flesh will be restricted. You can keep the flesh in a cage. You can keep the flesh under control. In order to help you to keep the flesh under control, Jesus Christ said, "Enter through the straight gate and follow the narrow way." There Jesus Christ said, few will find it. Some people think that all the poor people are through the straight gate and narrow way. Poverty or being poor is not the thing to judge whether the person has chosen the straight gate and narrow way. For a poor man who's having no house, maybe living under a dry bridge or under a tree in a small, tiny shed made of thrown away material. If you give him $200 million or if you give him 200 million thousands of lakhs of money, he will go and buy everything that he needed, and he'll make a beautiful house, and he'll buy everything what is needed. Even he may buy an air conditioner also, and he may buy a car also. Why he was there like that, living in that miserable condition? Because he didn't have the money. Still he had the desire. You may be a rich man. You may be having dozens of cars. You may be having an helicopter. You may be having a jet plane. You may be having a big mansion. You may be having a lot of money in the bank. Still you can choose the narrow way. How? You do not allow your flesh to get everything. The flesh is restricted through the straight gate. The flesh is restricted through the narrow way. And the flesh is controlled by the Spirit of God. You will tell the body. You will tell the soul. You will tell the flesh. Oh, flesh, I am not going to give you things. That's what Jesus Christ said. You know, when Jesus Christ was hungry after 40 days of fasting, Satan came forward with a suggestion. Why don't you make these stones as bread and eat? What Jesus said, hallelujah, what Jesus said, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but man will live by the word of God. That means Jesus said, I will not allow you, flesh, to enjoy everything. So even if you are a rich man, having millions of dollars in bank, still you can follow the straight, enter through the straight gate, follow the narrow way. That means you are every way, every desires are controlled by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. So God wants witnesses everywhere. God wants witnesses in the among the rich people. God wants witness among the common people. God wants witness among the poor people who are living poverty. Why? Living in that condition, they will witness the Lord. They will say, what a great joy I have in following the Lord. I praise and thank God for that experience. And God wants some people in the medium level so that they may show, tell the world that we are not after material thing. God may want some people in a very high level, very rich people. And as a witness, the rich person will stand and testify to the people of the world that I am not worried about the riches of the world. This riches has no value before me. Hallelujah. So, dearly beloved brothers and sisters, choose the narrow way. Enter through the straight gate. You know, some people think, let us turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12. There the Solomon says, 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12.
Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all, and in thine hand is power and might, and in thine hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all.
Here the word, when you read from the Old Testament, both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. If you just read that scripture only, then your heart will be longing for riches. But my dear friend, you should understand one mystery. That mystery we find in Hebrew chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. Hebrew chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. See, here God, who at sundry times and diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. See, God revealed himself little by little through conscience, through miracles, through the creations, through the prophets, little by little. But at the end, Jesus came. He brought the complete revelation of God. The prophets who lived before Jesus Christ did not get the complete revelation of God. Jesus, who is sitting in the bosom of the Father, brought the complete revelation of God. So, in the olden days, before Christ came, there were so many religions and so many Gentiles who worshipped gods and goddesses, thousands of gods and goddesses. People of that time were thinking that whose God is a stronger God will bless materially, will give lot of riches. So God the Almighty, God of Abraham, God of David, God of our fathers, blessed the people materially and declared to the world, I am the strongest God and I am the mighty God. Because people of that time were thinking, God who is strong will give material blessing. That's why Solomon says, riches come of you. But when Jesus Christ came, he brought the true revelation. He says, forsake the thing. Unless you forsake all, you cannot be my disciple. What a contrast. See, the Old Testament time, on the olden days, God blessed materially. But in the New Testament time, Jesus says, forsake what you have. It's not, instead of giving, he says, whatever things you have, you give it away, you forsake. What a contrast. Then if you see, in the olden time, God, the people of that time were thinking, whose God is the strongest God? That God will destroy their enemies completely. So when they go for war, they'll pray to their God and say, God, destroy our enemies completely. So when their enemies are completely destroyed, they start praising their God. Oh God, you are a mighty God. That's why our enemies are destroyed. So God began to bless Abraham and Israel, and they were able to destroy their enemies completely. By destroying the enemies, God proved to the world that he is the strongest God. He is the mighty God. But you know, when Jesus Christ brought the revelation, what Jesus said, love your enemy. Do not destroy your enemy, but love your enemy. And he says, bless the people who curse you. What a contrast, you know. Friends, please understand, the Old Testament people were prepared for a blessing on this land. People of Israel were blessed with the material blessing of this land. But for you and me, the chosen children of God, the bride of Christ, our blessing is yet to come. That blessing is in new heaven and new earth. That blessing is in new Jerusalem. So God's desire is to bless us with all the blessings of New Jerusalem. For that, we have to forsake the things of the world. Therefore, we have to choose the narrow path. Therefore, we have to choose the straight gate. Unless you choose the straight gate and follow the narrow path, you will not reach your destination. You look at Paul, Philippians chapter 3, Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 10. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 10. The Lord, how Paul, the Apostle Paul, he was a rich man of that time. You know, those days there were no colleges and universities. Only rich people used to teach their sons, they send their sons to curriculums, or to the places where the masters live. Their children will go and live with the master and study. And those people who were able, all people were not able to afford for such an expensive teaching. Paul got that kind of knowledge at the feet of Gamaliel, the big master of that time. You know, the history says Paul's family were having shipping business. Those days there were no cars, no trucks, no trains, no motorable things to carry the material things, transport material things from one place to another place. The people who were owning the ship, because sea was the main channel for transporting goods from one place to other place. So Paul's family were having shipping business. Those days ships were also not run by motor engines, but by wind and by oars and by mechanical methods. So they were having the shipping business. That means his community, Paul's family, were controlling the finance, controlling the financial things of that time. They were very rich commercial controllers. And not only that, he was an influential man. He had a very big name among Jews, and he was a member of Sanhedrin. No ordinary people won't get that position. So Paul was such a great man with all the wealth and all the positions and all kinds of comfortable and influence. You know, he, even the high priests were also I priests were also on his side. And then he says, he was a born Roman citizen. See, Roman citizen, getting Roman citizenship is not an easy thing. A person who's having Roman citizenship, ordinary police cannot arrest them. They enjoy special privilege. So Paul, the servant of God, had all these special privileges. What he says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. See, look at how Paul is entering through the straight gate. All things that were gained to him. See, the shipping business was a gainful thing. And being a member of Sanhedrin was a high position. And having a citizenship of Rome is an important thing. But before entering through the straight gate, he has forsaken all. Therefore, he says, but what things to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Ye doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. You know what Paul got? He got the knowledge of Jesus Christ. He came to know God came down as man. That was Jesus Christ. He came to know that Jesus Christ died on the cross for him. He came to know that God has an eternal plan of a new heaven and a new earth. He came to know that God has a plan of New Jerusalem. He knew that this earth is going to be destroyed. And when he came to know this great mystery of God, and when he recognized the love of God through the Lord Jesus Christ, what he did, he has forsaken everything. He prepared himself to enter through the narrow gate, to enter to the straight gate. These days, many people come to Christ to get some material things. Oh, they come and pray, Lord, if I get a good job, I'll follow you. Lord, if I get a good promotion, I'll follow you. Lord, if I get a good car, I'll follow you. God, if you bless me, bless my business, and make me a millionaire, I will follow you. My dear friend, you do not know the way of God. You know, all the glory of man of this world is just like flower of the grass. That's what we find in 1 Peter. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 24. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 24. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. Verse 25. But the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. All the glory of man is like flower of the grass. What Paul decided, what Paul thought, all my Roman citizenship and my big money from the shipping business and the big position in Sanhedrin and a big position of learned from at the Gamaliel's feet, all those things he counted as loss, and he bent down and chose that straight gate, the gate with obstacles. He entered through that straight gate. What he says, all things I counted as a loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. All those things he counted as loss for the excellency. Here he says, ye doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I suffered the loss of all things, I do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. When he looked about the knowledge of Christ and the love of Christ and the glory of Christ, all other thing he compared as dung, as garbage. On one side, Christ. On the other side, all material things. The high position in Roman society, high position in Jewish community, high position in Sanhedrin, high position financially, high position influentially. On the other side, he saw Christ. What was his condition? He didn't have money. What Jesus Christ said, when one man came and said, Master, I want to come to you and follow for you. Then Jesus said, foxes have their holes and birds have their nests, but the Son of God has no place to lay down his head. Look at the Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't have his own home when he wanted to enter into the city of Jerusalem. Normally people use horses, but what did he use? The poor man had no penny. He uses a colt of an ass. When some people came to ask for the tax, he didn't have money to pay the tax. What people, he said, go and get catch your, draw your net, and they got a fish, and in that, from the mouth of that fish, he took the tax money and gave them. He didn't have money. We read about his own disciple that when they were resting in a house, and when they came out in the morning, they were walking through the cornfield. They were full of hungry, and they plucked the corns and began to eat. They were living in that kind of condition. What Paul decided, I know this man of Galilee, this Jesus of Galilee, did not leave anything. He did not leave even his dress. His dress was also taken by people through lots. Though he left nothing on this earth, still he is God. He recognized Jesus Christ. When he recognized Jesus Christ, he understood this is more precious than all the silver and gold. Therefore, he left that broad way of enjoying. Oh, Christians, pastors, preachers, are you not on that broad way? Are you not after money? Are you not after fame? Are you not after a luxurious life? Are you not enjoying the world in the name of Jesus Christ? Can you say that you entered through the straight gate? You may be a preacher, you may be a great healer, but my healing brother, healer, your end is hellfire. You may be preaching wonderful things, but unless you enter through the straight gate to control your flesh, you will not get eternal life. Preacher, you will not get eternal life. Pastor, you will not get eternal life. Secretary, elder, committee member, organizer of the church, Sunday school teacher, if you are not choosing the straight gate, you will not enter into the kingdom of God, because your flesh will take you to hell. Why you are not choosing the straight gate and narrow path? Your flesh do not like it. Your flesh says it's very hard, it's very difficult. We should not choose that. Your flesh will take you to hellfire. Look at Paul, what he did. He counted loss for the knowledge so that he may win Christ. Then he says, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, but is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him. Look at the longing of Paul. I may know teachings are modern poisons. Modern poison to destroy you. Take away all the divine personality from you. Run away from that kind of preachers. Throw away those kinds of books. Those books and those preachers preaching will take you into hellfire. Brother, sister, you and I are not called to enjoy this world. We are under training. We are being prepared for the eternal life. That life is yet to come. I praise and thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ, who has revealed himself so that we may know what is the eternal program of God. You know, beloved friend, what our Lord Jesus Christ said, I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'll come again and take you to where I'll be in order to give you and me this wonderful message. God did not send an angel. God's second personality, Son, Jesus Christ, came directly to tell us this message. That's why John says in his last, we do not know what we shall be. One thing we know, when he shall appear, we shall be like him. Beloved brother and sister, young man and elderly man, pastor, preacher, would you try to follow the word of God? Would you pay attention to the wonderful words of God? What is the wonderful word of God? Get ready for the eternal hope. Detest, forsake, hate your father, worldly relationship, and then carry your cross. Take your cross. Take your suffering. Take the problems. Welcome the problems. Why these problems are there? These problems are against your flesh. The flesh wants always to enjoy. Flesh wants to be happy. Flesh wants to make fun. Flesh wants to be so happy. But cross is against the flesh. Cross and flesh should work like this. You should always welcome sufferings. Because of the flesh, you should welcome suffering. So these two things should go together. All the flesh is there, then the cross must be there, so that then both of them attack each other, and then you lead a peaceful life. So every brother and sister must be willing to take our own crosses of suffering. Cross, I doesn't mean that you put a wooden cross in your neck. Cross, I doesn't mean that you keep a golden cross or a silver cross. Cross means welcoming all kinds of suffering. Hallelujah. This suffering is a helper to us so that we may overcome the flesh. I praise and thank God. I pray that you may understand this word. I pray that this word may go deep in your heart. You may find this is very strange and very difficult, but this is good for you. If you follow this, then the joy of the Holy Spirit will come, and then you will rejoice. Then your wife will also start rejoicing. Your husband will also start rejoicing. Your parents will also start rejoicing, not by loving themselves, looking for that new place of God, looking for that heavenly place of God, looking for that city of God. Oh, Abraham waited for that city of God. My dear friend, Abraham, because he waited for the city of God, he continued to live in the tent. Hallelujah. Though he was not chosen for that, yet he got a glimpse of it. He got some message about it, that God is going to prepare a city for his own people. That's for us. That's for you and me. You are the chosen man. Oh, chosen man, chosen brother, chosen sister. Will you start denying? Will you start hating? Will you start distrusting your closest relationship so that you, your flesh may get disappointed? Your flesh may know, yes, this master is a tough master. I cannot come to him through the relatives. I cannot come to him through the loved ones. If I come through them, he will find out, he will detect me and attack me. Therefore, beloved, I request you to pray for a special prayer. Lord, help me to understand this plain word. Jesus Christ said, unless you deny, forsake all things, you cannot be my disciple. Nobody can overrule that. No one on earth can overrule that. Therefore, let's submit ourselves to the word of God and pray. Let us. These days we are studying the subject of victorious Christian life. Victorious Christian life is overcoming the flesh, crucifying the flesh. Now we are studying the subject of crucifying the flesh. The first step of crucifying the flesh is to deny ourselves. Crucifying the flesh includes our affection and lust. denying ourselves and forsake those things or detest those things which are attached to us more closely. Then there are some more steps which Jesus Christ has given to us. And that's we read Matthew chapter 11, verse 29 and 30. Matthew chapter 11, verse 29 and 30. Take my yoke. Many of you, the modern people, may not have seen yoke. And I'd like to draw a small picture of the yoke. And I believe our friends will be able to show you some yoke. That is, you know, yoke is, in the olden days, even now in India also, this yoke is being used to plow the field. Yoke is just like it's a rod, and it has two pieces of wood like this. And the ox's neck is brought in between these two pieces of wood. So this is the yoke. And then the plover will have a big rod connected to it, a big stick, a wooden piece connected to it, and then he plow the field. So Jesus Christ says, take the yoke. So when the ox or buffalo comes under the yoke, it cannot move freely or according to his own desire, because it is controlled by these two pieces of wood that comes around its neck. And then there is a rope also, a small rope. So the neck is completely, and that rope comes up to here. See, it is not only the wooden piece and the rope also. So the ox or the buffalo will come under the yoke, is not at all free to go on its own way. So Jesus Christ tells us to take his yoke. He is not putting the yoke upon us. You know, when after God has done everything for us, see, he has broken down the wall of partition. We were without God. We were aliens from God. He has brought us into his family. He has given us the grace to be born in his family. All these things God did for ourselves through Jesus Christ. Now the rest of the thing of working out our own salvation, we have to do voluntarily. We have to deny ourselves. We have to take the cross by ourselves. We have to detest or forsake our own dear ones. So that, because they are all temporary relationships. For the eternal relationship, we have to forsake those temporary relationships. And here Jesus Christ says, take the yoke. Now, about the yoke is not, it is not one component. You can find the yoke here. You can look at here, the yoke. It is not one component. Here's a piece of wood. Here's another piece of wood. This is another piece of wood. This is another piece of wood. And there is one plow hand below that. And the rope. So the yoke comprises of different components. In the same way, the yoke of Jesus Christ, we find in the book of Matthew chapter 5, 6 and 7. The yoke means the teachings of Jesus Christ. Teachings of Jesus Christ. So if you read Matthew chapter 5, 6 and 7, you'll find the different components of the yoke. Now, for your learning, I'll read one or two components so that you can understand the rest of the things. The one of the component of the yoke we find in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 45. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 45. Love your enemies. My dear friend, here God, Jesus Christ, speaks a very difficult one to follow. It is naturally impossible to love our enemies. Our flesh will always be encouraging us to hate our enemy, to attack him, to retaliate, to revenge. But the love of God, the yoke of Jesus Christ, The teaching of Jesus Christ says, love your enemies. That means through the Holy Spirit, all the hatred that's in our heart for the enemy is removed. And then a love has come, affection has come in our heart. It is impossible by the human nature. Always our flesh, our nature, our carnal nature will hate to do that, will oppose to do that. But when you put the yoke of Christ on you, you will have to love your enemy. How that is possible? When you pray, the flesh that encourages you, the carnal mind that encourages to detest or hate that enemy, you pray, God, grant me grace through the Holy Spirit so that my carnal desire, that rebellious nature, that flesh in me that tells me to retaliate, to oppose, oh Holy Spirit, help me to suppress it, and in the place of hatred, let love come in my heart for him. So this is not an easy thing. So this yoke you have to take. If you have to overcome your flesh, if you have to crucify your flesh, you have to take the yoke of Jesus Christ. What is that one component? Loving our enemies. Friends, have you tried this? Of course, you may not be retaliating against your enemies. Your neighbor may be working against you. You may not be retaliating. You may be praying, God, remove this enemy from before me. Lord, this neighbor is creating a lot of trouble. Or in your working place, there is a friend who is working, always talking against you. Or your neighborhood, or in the church also, sometimes you may get some people who are against you. You may be praying, Lord, he is a devil. Take away this devil from me, Lord. This neighbor is a devil. Lord, please remove this devil from me. But what the word of God says, no, my son, my daughter, that is not the way. If you do that way, then your flesh will overcome you. If you want to keep your flesh crucified, what you should pray, oh God, grant me grace to love my enemy. And you know, there it says, love your enemies, bless them that curse you. Lord, that person is cursing me. Instead of retaliating with a curse, help me to bless him. And then, do good to them that hate you. Oh Lord, that person is always doing something against me. Help me to do something good to that person. And pray for them which despitefully use you, the people who make fun of you, the people who use you for their own benefit. Pray for them and persecute you. My friends, in my life, I've been persecuted 15 times. I've been beaten badly. I've been kicked down. I've been knocked down. And I've been the people, after knocking me down on the ground, and they dragged me on the ground. And you know how many times I've been beaten and hit. But I thank God I never had hatred towards them. Even when they pulled me to the court, even the judge, when they asked me, why, tell their names. Then I said, I will not tell their names. They are my friends. You know, when they beat me, it is not an easy fun. They beat on your head, on your chest, on your body, and they knock you down. They gnashing their teeth and come and attack to kill you. You know, this body which you see, I've been attacked 15 times. I've been on deathbed. My condition was very, very serious. They knock me down and they kick on my head, kick on my chest, kick on my ribs. Oh, they do all kinds of things. They strip me naked. But even then, I thank God for the love of the Holy. I thank God for the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost always gave love for me towards them. I never felt hatred towards them. I began to pray for them. I am glad to say that one of the person who kicked me, one of the person who slapped me, hit me publicly, he is a servant of God now. He said later on, after some years, this was working in him. Oh, this man, even after after we beaten him, even when the police asked about their name, even the court, the judges asked the names who are persecuted, he did not say, he said, they are my friends. Those words worked in his heart and God helped him, and now he is a servant of God. I thank God for the love of God. So my dear friend, if you take the yoke of Jesus Christ, the one of the component is loving the enemy, praying for the people who persecute you, love doing good to them that hate us, my friend. Will you try to do that? You may be praying, Lord, save me from his hand. Instead of that, would you try to love that person? If you take the yoke of Jesus Christ, automatically your flesh, your carnal mind will come under control. You may be praying, Lord, remove this carnal mind. Remove this carnal mind. Yes, the Lord is ready to remove the carnal mind, provided you follow the way of the Lord. You follow the teachings of the Lord. What is the teaching of the Lord? Love your enemy. Love your enemy. Bless them that curse you. The person who is always cursing you, always shouting against you. You are blessing him. And then do good to them that hate you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Hallelujah, my dear friend. Have you ever thought of this component of the yoke? Lord, enable me to love my enemies. Through the Holy Ghost, you will get the love, agape love. With natural love, it is not possible. Natural love. Human love. Human love, what it is? The human love, we read verse 46, we 45 and 46, we read that you 46. For if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans also do? Be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. Hallelujah. We love them, those love us. We greet them, those greet us. But my dear friend, in my personal experience, where I live in Jammu Bakshinagar. When I see some people are very angry over me, I just say in Hindi, Namaste. I just say Hindi, something, Namaste or something, or Jai Hind or something like that. So I know some people, they were very angry over me because they know what I'm doing, because they were angry over me because I preach the gospel and several Hindus are coming to the Lord. They are full of anger towards me. But what I do when I pass by them, I just greet myself. Even they are younger than me in age, I just greet them. And now I see when some of them go away before me, or some of them smile. Hallelujah. Friends, I plead with you. Please take this component of loving our enemy. It is very important. And then let us go to the other component. That's what we find. Matthew chapter 5 verse 13. Matthew chapter 5 verse 13. Yes.
Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men.
Here, the other component, Jesus Christ says, you are the salt of the earth. Earth means for the whole world. See, you put the component. Yes, I have to be the salt. See, read Colossians chapter 4 verse 6 along with that. Colossians chapter 4 verse 6. There, Paul explains about it a bit more clearly. Colossians chapter 4 verse 6.
Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man.
Here he says, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how you ought to answer every man. Friend, you are The salt of the earth means you are the salt in the food. If you do not have salt, these days there are a lot of blood pressure and other thing. People avoid salt and then they practice it. You know how tasteless it is. But when you use, you remember the days when you eat salt, you have salt with your food. If you do not have sufficient salt in your food, it is not tasty. And when you add sufficient salt, then you can taste it well, whether whatever food it is. There, in the same way, when people see us through our conversation, we should be acceptable to them, tasty to them. Hallelujah. It is not that, oh, that person is doing something against me, so I should speak against to him. No. Our conversation should be always seasoned with salt, that whatever things come out from me, from us, whatever the conversation, whatever you do, sometimes, you know, we do something for the people who do against us, we do things against them. Talk bad, we retaliate bad. No, not that. But the yoke of Christ, when you take the yoke of Christ, your conversation will be seasoned with salt. You are the salt of the earth. Here it says, you are the salt of the earth. But if that salt have lost its sour, wherewith shall it be salted? And what it means, it is henceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. My dear friend, in the area where you live, in the community where you are working, or in the factory or office or the place where you are working, or where you are studying, where you are teaching, or in the hospital where you are doing, whether as a doctor or as a nurse, or whatever you are doing, or you may be a lawyer, whatever you may be doing, my dear friend, have you ever thought, oh Lord, I am the salt of the whole people of my institution. Lord, I am the salt of the whole neighbors. Lord, the neighbor may be a Muslim, may be a Hindu, may be an atheist, may be a Buddhist, may be a drunkard, may be a dacoit, may be a thief, or whoever it might be. Lord, let him experience salt from me. Let my conversation, let my behavior be a tasty to him. Not that after they talk to you once, not after they look on your face, they turn away their face. No, once they look their face. You know, earlier I was staying in Udhampur, Gadi. There some people were against us. There was one postman, old postmaster. He's a sick gentleman. He was a sick gentleman. So when God told me to move down from Udhampur, Gadi to Jammu, I came and I started ministry. After some years, when I went there, then he came out and said, oh, he called me Samuel Saab, you have left this place. Whenever you walk on this place, then you walk in front of the post office. I used to watch you. You are always smiling. And now, when you have gone down, we find that the sun is set here. There is no, we don't find that kind of joy. See, he is a man from Sikh religion. But from my behavior, he got something good. He got something wonderful. He said, after you left this place, we feel so bad. Because whenever I used to walk, my behavior with them, though they speak against me, though they accuse me, though they curse me, I used to bear this yoke on me, that whoever see me, where maybe my enemies, maybe they may sworn enemy, oh, is always hating me, I used to smile at them, because I thank God I voluntarily took the yoke of Christ on me. Because if I don't take the yoke on me, the flesh in me will rise up and come against me. I thank God for the yoke of Christ. Hallelujah. So I praise and thank for Jesus Christ who gave me this opportunity to take the yoke. Then next one is Matthew chapter 5 verse 14, 15 and 16. Matthew chapter 5 verse 14, 15 and 16. You are the light of the world. See, you are the light not only just for you. You are the light of the world. In your neighborhood, if the darkness is there, my dear friend, your light should come. Your light in you should remove that darkness. Do you know? Light overcomes always darkness. Darkness can never defeat light. Think that you are in a room of pitch darkness. You cannot see anything at all. Pitch darkness. You take a small matchstick or candle, a small candle. It has got a very little light only. Then the pitch darkness will not say, "Oh, I will not go away before this small light. I will go away when the glorious big light comes." You can find even that small light of that candlestick or the matchstick, the thick pitch darkness there is immediately pressed down. So in the same way, my dear brother and sister, remember, you are the light of the world. In your neighborhood, if darkness is increasing, the work of Satan is increasing, it is because you are not giving sufficient light to that place. That's why Satan is hiding there. That's why wicked people are hiding there. It is possible that where you stay, there may be a dancing hall. Dancing hall where girls may be dancing, girls and men may be doing all kinds of dirty dances and naked dancers, and they may be doing all kinds of evil things. There may be a liquor shop. There may be so many other things. Evil is increasing. Why? Your light, you are not shining. What you do? You keep the light for yourself and for your family or for your own relative people or the people whom you like. What you should do? You go out into the dark places and stand there. God has given me the grace to go to the drunkard places. God has given me the grace to the place of prostitutes where the prostitutes say. And God given me the grace to go to the place where the people do the gambling. And I walk around up and down. And I say, "Lord, I am the light here. Let the darkness that blinded these people who are groping in darkness, their eyes may be opened." So beloved brother, beloved sister, elder, young man, young boy, I plead with you. Remember, you are the light of the world. The light is not, here it says, you are the light of the world, and then a city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. You are on a hill. You are on the hill of Calvary. You are on the Calvary hill. Oh, the cross of Jesus Christ is not hidden down in the valley. It is in the Calvary hill, on the mountain hill, so the people can see. In the same way, you are on the hill, so people can see you. You don't get, you don't go and hide yourself. There is written, "Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house." So in the house, if there is a candle, you do not put it under the cot or not in the bushel, but keep it on a candlestick so that all people around may know it. Similarly, wherever you are living, whatever you are doing, in your working place, in your study place, in your house, in your neighborhood, wherever you are traveling, remember, take this yoke. Oh, I am the light. I am the light. The other component of the yoke is I am the light. I am not supposed to hide here. I should come out and expose myself. The glorious light that is working in me should be seen by the people. You know the light, Philippians chapter 2 verse 15. Where you should do the light? Where? Philippians chapter 2 verse 15.
"That ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world."
Here, see, "that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke in the midst of crooked and perverse people." Crooked. See, my dear friend, you have to be light before crooked people. You have to be light before the perverse nation. In my life, I can tell you, and I want to tell you one incident. We purchased a plot of land in Udhampur Gadi. The tahsildar, the man who is supposed to, the official man, the officer of the government, and his assistants all came, tahsildar and the people connected with that they came and put the mark of the ground, because I purchased it with a lot of money to start a prayer house of prayer there and to make a training center for the people. So some people were against it, but I had to pay a heavy price. And then I brought the tahsildar, the main government officer, and the owner of the land, and they put all the mark and everything. And the next morning, when I went there with the laborers to dig for the compound wall, I found that the marking was brought down about 1.5 feet down. Then the laborers told me, "See, yesterday the mark was about 1.5 feet up. It has come for 1.5 feet down." Then I said to the laborers, "Take 1.5 feet more down and put it there and start digging." And then they brought the 1.5 feet and started digging. The neighbor who grasped that land, who put the 1.5 feet down, he came, "Oh, sir, why do you go that way? I took 1.5 feet yesterday." I said, "Why do you do that?" "Because I wanted to construct some toilets and other things and all." I said, "My Jesus has told me that if you ask, I should do something more. So that's why I've given 1.5 feet more." You know what they were? They thought that if I quarrel for them, he brought some people to quarrel with me with iron rods and other things. If I quarrel with them, they were ready to fight against me. Instead of fighting against me, I given them 1.5 feet more. Of course, it is a great loss. 1.5 feet for a long distance is a lot of land. But to follow the words of Jesus, you know, he was the troublesome. He used to make liquor in his house. So he was a headache for the police people. You know, once the police officer came and said to me, "Well, he only honors you. He only accept your advices. We cannot also control him. You please tell him to do like this." See, the most troublemaker of my place became a slave-like man for me. I saw him. Whenever I walk, he stand up and greet me. Afterwards, he never behaved in a wrong way. Why? He could see I was putting on the yoke of Jesus Christ. So, beloved, we have to shine as light before the crooked people, perverse nation. They may take undue advantage of you. Hallelujah. Are you ready to do that? Lord, see, here it says that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of the crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Amongst last lights of the world. So whatever be the nature of the other man, my friend, you are the disciple of Jesus Christ. You have to pull down your flesh. What your flesh will say, retaliate, retaliate. Do bad to him. See, he's attacking you. Retaliate. But you put the yoke, the teaching of Jesus Christ upon that. Then he comes down. He remains quiet. He cannot speak anything more. So in order to bring your flesh under control, what you have to do, put on that yoke. Yes, for the crooked people. The crooked people also. I'll submit myself. That's a very hard thing. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 6 and 7, we read.
But
1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 6 and 7. Oh, it's very hard. When you know people are robbing you, when you know people are taking undue advantages of you, we should allow you us to be defrauded. My dear friends, I tasted all of it. If you come to the place where I live in Bachinagar, Jammu, the people who once spoke against me, the people who wanted to defraud me, rob everything, I just submitted myself, allowed them to defraud me. Not one case, so many cases. Why I do that? My flesh in me says, retaliate. No, I am the disciple of Jesus Christ. I should overcome the carnal mind. I should allow myself to be defrauded. Along with that, read Matthew chapter 5, verse 40 and 41. There Jesus Christ teaches some important thing. Matthew chapter 5, verse 40 and 41.
And if any man will sue thee at the law, and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain.
Here, see, the word of God says, Jesus says, if any man will sue thee at the law, and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. See, what is the teaching of Jesus Christ? If you take these components of the yoke, then only your carnal mind will come under control. I practically tested this. Now in Jammu, because I want to tell you practically, instead of just preaching is not enough. Because you should know what I'm preaching is right, and I experience it, and I live a life like that. So therefore, by the grace of God, God has given me the grace. The Holy Spirit helps me to live according to this word. In Jammu city, when we started the work some years ago, or 20 years ago, God has given me a burden to buy a plot, a good plot near the bus stand, and near the so that people who come from distant places of Jammu Kashmir, from the mountains of Kashmir, mountains of Rajouri, they can easily come to the place. So I bought a place from the government, you know, the transactions were continuing and the conversation was continuing, and from the government I given money and purchased a plot, big plot, so that I thought they'll have a bookstore, Bible bookstore, because there was no Bible bookstore in the whole Jammu city. Jammu is the capital city of Jammu and Kashmir. There were no Bible depots or Bible bookstore or Christian bookstore there. So I thought we'll have a Bible bookstore, and then we'll have a place for the pastors and people to live, and I thought we'll have a place for the students to live and have a Bible school, and then have a good worshiping place. It's a big land, very costly land. We purchased it. And then I allowed one pastor to come and stay there. And slowly this pastor secretly sold portion of that land. He then, because he was a man of lot of money, a man after money, for love of money, and he took that money. Then later on I thought with the presbytery, this man is not doing good. Then we thought we'll transfer him from that place. But this man became wild. Then I thought, it's not good to fight here. Then after 1 year, I thought, okay, we will, because a big land, he has taken some portion. Then we will do a construction in the other portion. Then he agreed. Okay, I just see the main portion, the land is totally purchased by me. I paid the whole money. Everything is with me. But he, by force, he just occupied it. And then the other place, he agreed, okay. So then I spent a lot of money to put a big wall. And when the construction was going on one evening, what he did, he started removing some of the bricks. Then the next day when our brothers went there, they saw the bricks were removed. Then they reported to me. Then I said, friends, he has removed that brick, so he wanted to pick up a quarrel with us. His eye may be on that other land also. I said, pack up everything, come away. Immediately. Until this moment, we are living in rented house. We don't have a house of our own. The land which we purchased for our own purpose is in the custody. It is lying vacant there. And he has considered something lying vacant there. That land is very costly now. The hotels have come, and it is in a very hot place, a very costly place. With several, it's millions and millions of rupees worth place now. You know, I live in the rented house. Once the house owner of where I live came and started kicking on the door. He said, because we preach the word of God and the Hindus come to the Lord, the house owner is a Hindu. So he kicked on the door and said, you vacate the house by tomorrow. If you don't vacate the house, I'll take out your stomach. He was so angry. Then I thought in the morning, oh, this our land which we purchased is lying vacant there, and the other man is only occupied. I'll go and tell him we'll go and start constructing a house for us, constructing a worshipping place for us, a small living place for us. I thought, and I took a small scooter, and that place was about 1.5 kilometers away from the place where I stay in rented house. When I that was in the morning time. When I went near, about 400 yards away, some voice from my heart says, Samuel, do you want the land or do you want the word of God? You know what the word of God at that time came to me. If any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. See, he did not sue me. He just grabbed it. Then, do you know what I said to myself, to my flesh? See, my flesh came up. Okay, go and take up that land and construct the house. You know what I told to my flesh? If you trouble me anymore, even I will give the scooter also to that man. I go back on foot. My dear friend, to follow this word, I had to suffer a lot. Still now, I am living in a rented house. And this being recorded from a rented house room, in a temporary room. This is not our own room. When our own place which I purchased is about 1.5 kilometers away, beautiful place is there, now lying vacant, very costly place. For to follow this word of Jesus Christ, what I want that component of the yoke of Jesus Christ upon me. That component of yoke of Jesus Christ upon me. For that purpose, I still stay in Jammu. Hallelujah. Therefore, my beloved brother, beloved sister, you may be quarreling for your job. You may be fighting for your promotion. You may be doing many things against, so that you may, these days we fight for our right. It's a usual thing. Fight for our rights. Fight for our rights. I want to tell you one incident. You may laugh at me. See, we were traveling in the train. With me, there were brothers and sisters as a team. We were going. We booked our berths, sleeper berths. And while we were traveling, when we came to the station, some people came and occupied it by force. See, a group of people came and occupied our place by force. Then I thought, it's our right. We paid the money. Then I began to argue with that man. And while arguing, some rough words came out of me. I did not abuse him. I did not use any filthy language. But my conversation was not salted. It was not seasoned with salt. So some words came. Then after a few minutes, the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. Oh, what? What did you do? What kind of words came out from you? Then you know what I did. Lord, I will punish myself which has come out. You know, I went to the toilet. You know, in the railway second class sleeper in India, you know the toilets are not clean. It's dirty. What I said, flesh, you will clean this toilet. So I began to clean that toilet with all my hand, and I given punishment to my flesh. You instigated me to speak against that people. Then I cleaned it, and then I came, you know. Then I started praying, Lord, grant me grace to make friendship with these people. You know, within an hour, God has given me grace to become friendly with him. Why? Friendly with those people who have robbed our seat, who have occupied our seat. Friends, we have to carry the yoke always. These are the days we are fighting for the right. You know, Jesus Christ said, we are not of this world. Whatever the right of the people of the world take for themselves, we have no right. We are the citizens of the heavenly kingdom. You must understand, the whole earth is under the influence of the earth. Satan uses the people, his own people, so that he may attack you. Your testimony is lost. When people demand something. What Jesus Christ said, if any man sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. We are the citizens of New Jerusalem. We are the citizens of new heaven and earth. We are the citizens of the kingdom of God. So we should shine before them. And here Jesus Christ said, whosoever shall cumble thee to go a mile, go with him to him. In those days, you cannot understand that. Those days, many robbers were there in Jerusalem, in the land of Israel. And when the people go to Samaria, there were so many lonely places, dark places, where the robbers, thieves used to hide and attack people. So when people go through that way during the night time, what the people used to do, the healthy people, strong people, drag one person. Come on, you will have to walk with me. You'll have to walk with me. They take a companion, because if a companion is there, the robber, the thief who is hiding, he will not attack. So what they used to do from the marketplace, they drag a man, a helpless man. Come on with me. Cumble him. Come on, you walk with me. Because he cumbles him so that when he walked through that lonely place, the robbers may not attack him, thief may not attack him. If this man whom he has taken by force, if he goes, and then when he comes back, the thieves will definitely attack him. So therefore, in those days, they used to take people like that. Whenever they lonely, the people who are healthy, people are influential, they used to take people. Those days there were so many slaves also. There were so many people who didn't have much of the saying. They are common people. These healthy people, these wealthy people, the people of influence will drag these people. Come on, walk with me for a mile. So that he can cross the lonely place where the thieves hide. So this man will have to go with him talking, and then when this man comes back, he will certainly be attacked by the thieves. So therefore Jesus Christ said, if any man cumble you to walk a mile, go one more mile. That means putting your own self in danger, go with that man. You know, this is the way, this is the component of the yoke. Friend, I can tell you, by the grace of God, I am carrying the yoke of Jesus Christ on me. I am carrying the yoke of Jesus Christ on me. This is not some hypocrisy. This is not something preaching and something doing outwardly. No, practically, you can see in my personal life, I am carrying the yoke of Christ on me. Hallelujah. I know the sweetness of carrying the yoke of Jesus Christ. What do you know? When I carry the yoke of Jesus Christ is also with me. Friend, if you want to overcome your flesh, if you want to overcome your carnal mind, if you want to crucify your flesh, the only way is take the yoke of Jesus Christ. And the yoke has got different components. I'll continue that components, the components which I shared with you. Well, number one is you are the salt of the earth. Number two, you are the light of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. And number three, even when people file case against us, we should allow them to defraud us. Okay, you do it. You know, you carry on. You do whatever you want to do it. You know, there was an occasion. You know, some people raised an allegation against me. A sexual scandal about another lady. They said I committed adultery with her. I just kept quiet. But this lady's husband became very angry. And they filed a suit against that person. And defamation case. I was not in this place. Then I went. When I came back, I went for preaching to another place. When I came back, I heard that this person raised some allegation against me, and this lady's husband raised a defamation case. Then I called the lady and the husband, and I said, if you do not withdraw that defamation case against that person, you cannot be in fellowship with me. Then they said, oh, see, they can do harms like that. They can tell stories like that. Then I said, our way is the path of allegation. Our way is the path in which Jesus Christ has walked. I said, seven witnesses stood against Jesus Christ and raised so many false allegations. We have to rejoice. That's why Jesus Christ said, you know, when people speak against you, verse Matthew chapter 5, verse 11, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. You know, when I said, brother, withdraw that defamation case, he began to cry. His wife began to cry. Then his wife and husband began to say, we'll have to carry this blame always. I said, bear it for the sake of Jesus Christ. Bear it for the sake of Jesus Christ. In tears, I told them. Then they sent a lawyer notice to that person who raised the allegation. He was frightened. Because there was it was absolutely total lie. There was not even 1% of truth in it. Total lie. 100% lie. There is no truth at all in it. He knew it. But he wanted to do something like that. So, but then man was frightened. But the lawyers also sent notice to that man who raised that complaint. And when he has withdrawn the case, Then only that man was released. But by that man was silenced. I praise and thank God. My dear friend, my friend, you are the disciple of Jesus Christ. Do you have the yoke on you? I'm teaching you with the yoke on me. I'm teaching you this word with the yoke of Christ on me. I'm not talking outwardly. I'm not talking superfluently. I'm talking to you with practical experience. Do you have the yoke of Christ on you? If you do not have the yoke, today, make up your mind. Oh Lord, help me to take the yoke upon me. Then your flesh will come under control. Your flesh will be, you can crucify your flesh. Now we'll sing a song, and then we have been studying about victorious Christian life in continuation of that series. We are studying how to overcome the flesh. And in the other cassette you heard, the other CD you heard about taking the yoke of Jesus Christ. And I explained the yoke we find in Matthew chapter 5, 6 and 7. And I explained about it. Now, in continuation of the yoke, the other component of the yoke, we find in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. In continuation of the yoke, this is not a separate one, but the other component of the yoke we find in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. I'd like to show you, see, straight. Here in the Word of God it says straight. Straight gate, the meaning is, in Greek it is stenos. Stenos means, on that door there are so many obstacles standing close. That is, as a small door, there are obstacles up and down and left and right. You cannot go easily. That you mean by straight gate. There are doors or gates which wide open. There is explained about two gates. One is the broad gate, large, very, see, the wide gate and the broad way. Then there is a straight gate, the narrow way. The straight means the way, the gate itself, though it is very, very small, yet there are obstacles. The word stenos means that on the way of that door, of that gate, there are obstacles. Something is protruding here and there so that you cannot just go in like that. You'll have to bend yourself. You have to adjust yourself according. Then only you can get in there. Then the narrow means tlipo. Tlipo means afflicted, hurt. When you walk in that way, you will get afflicted. Narrow means tlipo. Tlipo means When you walk on that way, you get afflicted. So friend, the other component of this yoke of Christ is choosing the straight gate and narrow way. There are so many options before a child of God. He can walk through a broad way, getting all comfort of this world, broad gate and wide gate, and walk through the broad way, but the end will be destruction. Why? The flesh, which always after enjoying things of the world, will take you out of the way, and finally you will end up in the lake of fire. Because of your flesh, friend, Jesus spoke to you. Jesus tells us, Jesus teaches us that we choose the straight gate. The straight gate means you cannot go as you are. You had to bend. There are some obstacles at the gate itself. Unless you bend and adjust your body to kneel down, you may have to kneel down, you may have to bow down. Then only you will be able to enter into that straight gate. That's why the word stenos means some obstacles are there. So some obstacles, the straight, remember, the straight is there are some obstacles. When you try to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, there will be some obstacles. It is not easy to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Because when you come to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, obstacles will be there from your family, from your father, from your mother, from your wife, and from your children, from your relatives. And physically there will be some obstacles. So many things. So it is not well accepted wide gate. It's a straight gate. So when you prepare yourself to go through the straight gate, your flesh in you will cry and say, no, 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 this is not the way. Because the flesh in you will never agree the path of suffering. The flesh always wants to enjoy, make yourself comfortable, happy, and life of luxury. So the way for a person who wants to enter into eternal life, he must choose the straight gate. See, some people think that I've accepted Jesus Christ, I'm taken water baptism, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, I am already entered through the straight gate. No, my dear brother, you may be a pastor, you may be a preacher, you may be a great evangelist healing many people, but still you may be outside the gate. God brought you to the way of experience of salvation and water baptism and of the Holy Spirit. And God has given you the gift of healing and so many things. But yet, for your own eternal life, my friend, you will have to choose the straight gate. These days, many servants of God think that when I start the ministry in the beginning, it will be a lot of suffering, lot of problem, lot of difficulties. And then after I suffer for a while, God will begin to bless me materially. And then I will have many material things and I'll grow up. You know, I want you to turn your attention to Paul. Paul speaks about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Paul speaks about 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9 to 13. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 9 to 13. Please find word what Paul says. Even unto this present hour we both hunger and thirst and are naked and are buffeted and have no sweat and dwelling place. See, he is the apostle. So many think that when we start in the ministry, in the beginning there will be troubles, hardship. But as you grow in the ministry, there will be plenty of things. My dear friend, that is that experience of a servant of God who has chosen the wide gate and walking through the broad way. But for a child of God, who knows about the mystery of the flesh that dwells in him will choose that straight gate. Means entering through the straight gates is not easy. It is painful. And then the way is also narrow. The narrow, I already explained to you, tlipo. Tlipo means when you walk in that narrow way, you will get afflicted. You will get wounded. You will get painful. Means there are some ways which are full of good roads and bed of roses. But the path of a true believer is a path of thorns. When you walk through the thorns, certainly you will get hurt. Many people do not know this mystery. Friend, why God wants you to choose the straight gate and the narrow way? The reason for it, your flesh is restricted. Your flesh is controlled. The flesh is not allowed to choose his own way to make life more comfortable. If you allow your flesh to have a comfortable life, then definitely it will take to hellfire. For your salvation, you need not walk through the narrow gate. For your salvation, you need not enter through the straight gate. According to the Eastern religions and some religions of the world, they teach people to penalize their own body, to penalize themselves so that you may get salvation. They tell people to walk on their knees. They tell people to walk on the their knees, and sometimes people just crawl to reach that place. That means they are penalizing, they are punishing their own body to get salvation. That is not the way of God. God himself took the suffering. I have seen some people in India, sadhus in India, they make a slipper with full of nails. The nails, the sharp point of the nails will be upward. Their feet will be on the nails. That means whenever they walk, that nail pointed nails goes inside their feet. So they get pain. They are paying that price so that they may be able to overcome sin. That is not the way. Some people stand on one leg and keep on fasting so that they can penalize for their sins. That is not the way. Jesus Christ took all that punishment for you and for me, for all our past sins, all the sins that have come through Adam and Eve. Jesus Christ has paid the price on the cross of Calvary. But now you have a flesh. And that flesh is a luxury enjoying flesh. The flesh is always after comfortable things. The flesh is always after easy things. And if you allow your flesh to have an easy life, a free way, my dear friend, remember that you will certainly end up in great trouble. You go into destruction. But if you choose the narrow way, and if you choose the straight gate, your flesh will be restricted. You can keep the flesh in a cage. You can keep the flesh under control. In order to help you to keep the flesh under control, Jesus Christ said, "We enter through the straight gate and follow the narrow way." There Jesus Christ said, few will find it. Some people think that all the poor people are through the straight gate and narrow way. Poverty or being poor is not the thing to judge whether the person has chosen the straight gate and narrow way. For a poor man who's having no house, maybe living under a dry bridge or under a tree in a small, tiny shed made of thrown away material. If you give him $200 million Or if you give him 200 million thousands of lakhs of money, he will go and buy everything that you needed, and he'll make a beautiful house, and he'll buy everything what is needed. Even he may buy an air conditioner also, and he may buy a car also. Why he was there like that, living in that miserable condition? Because he didn't have the money. Still he had a desire. You may be a rich man. You may be having dozens of cars. You may be having an helicopter. You may be having a jet plane. You may be having a big mansion. You may be having a lot of money in the bank. Still, you can choose the narrow way. How? You do not allow your flesh to get everything. The flesh is restricted through the straight gate. The flesh is restricted through the narrow way. And the flesh is controlled by the Spirit of God. You will tell the body, you will tell the soul, you will tell the flesh, oh flesh, I am not going to give you things. That's what Jesus Christ said. You know, when Jesus Christ was hungry after 40 days of fasting, Satan came forward with a suggestion. Why don't you make these stones as bread and eat? What Jesus said, hallelujah, what Jesus said, he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but man will live by the word of God. That means Jesus said, I will not allow you, flesh, to enjoy everything. So even if you are a rich man, having millions of dollars in bank, still you can follow the straight, enter through the straight gate, follow the narrow way. That means you are every way, every desires are controlled by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. So God wants witnesses everywhere. God wants witnesses in the among the rich people. God wants witnesses among the common people. God wants witnesses among the poor people who are living poverty. Why? Living in that condition, they will witness the Lord. They will say, what a great joy I have in following the Lord. I praise and thank God for that experience. And God wants some people in the medium level so that they may show, tell the world that we are not after material thing. God may want some people in a very high level, very rich people. And as a witness, the rich person will stand and testify to the people of the world that I am not worried about the riches of the world. These riches has no value before me. Hallelujah. So, dearly beloved brothers and sisters, choose the narrow way. Enter through the straight gate. You know, some people think, let us turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12. There the Solomon says, 1 Chronicles chapter 29 verse 12.
Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thine hand is power and might, and in thine hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all.
Here the word, when you read from the Old Testament, both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. If you just read that scripture only, then your heart will be longing for riches. But my dear friend, you should understand one mystery. That mystery we find in Hebrew chapter 1 verse 1 and 2. Hebrew chapter 1 verse 1 and 2. See, here God, who at sundry times and diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. See, God revealed himself little by little through conscience, through miracles, through the creations, through the prophets, little by little. But at the end, Jesus came. He brought the complete revelation of God. The prophets who lived before Jesus Christ did not get the complete revelation of God. Jesus, who is sitting in the bosom of the Father, brought the complete revelation of God. So, in the olden days, before Christ came, there were so many religions and so many Gentiles who worshipped gods and goddesses, thousands of gods and goddesses. People of that time were thinking that whose God is a stronger God will bless materially, will give lot of riches. So God the Almighty, God of Abraham, God of David, God of our fathers, blessed the people materially and declared to the world, I am the strongest God and I am the mighty God. Because people of that time were thinking, God who is strong will give material blessing. That's why Solomon says, riches come of you. But when Jesus Christ came, he brought the true revelation. He says, forsake the thing. Unless you forsake all, you cannot be my disciple. What a contrast. See, the Old Testament time, on the olden days, God blessed materially. But in the New Testament time, Jesus says, forsake what you have. It's not, instead of giving, he says, whatever things you have, you give it away, you forsake. What a contrast. Then if you see, in the olden time, God, the people of that time were thinking, whose God is the strongest God? That God will destroy their enemies completely. So when they go for war, they'll pray to their God and say, God, destroy our enemies completely. So when their enemies are completely destroyed, they start praising their God. Oh God, you are a mighty God. That's why our enemies are destroyed. So God began to bless Abraham and Israel, and they were able to destroy their enemies completely. By destroying the enemies, God proved to the world that he is the strongest God. He is the mighty God. But you know, when Jesus Christ brought the revelation, what Jesus said, love your enemy. Do not destroy your enemy, but love your enemy. And he says, bless the people who curse you. What a contrast, you know. Friends, please understand, the Old Testament people were prepared for a blessing on this land. People of Israel were blessed with the material blessing of this land. But for you and me, the chosen children of God, the bride of Christ, our blessing is yet to come. That blessing is in new heaven and new earth. That blessing is in new Jerusalem. So God's desire is to bless us with all the blessings of New Jerusalem. For that, we have to forsake the things of the world. Therefore, we have to choose the narrow path. Therefore, we have to choose the straight gate. Unless you choose the straight gate and follow the narrow path, you will not reach your destination. You look at Paul, Philippians chapter 3, Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 10. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 10. You know the Lord, how Paul, the Apostle Paul, he was a rich man of that time. You know, those days there were no colleges and universities. Only rich people used to teach their sons, they send their sons to curriculums or to the places where the masters live. Their children will go and live with the master and study. And those people who were able, all people were not able to afford for such an expensive teaching. Paul got that kind of knowledge at the feet of Gamaliel, the big master of that time. You know, the history says Paul's family were having shipping business. Those days there were no cars, no trucks, no trains, no motorable things to carry the material things, transport material things from one place to another place. The people who were owning the ship, because sea was the main channel for transporting goods from one place to other place. So Paul's family were having shipping business. Those days, ships were also not run by motor engines, but by wind and by oars and by mechanical methods. So they were having the shipping business. That means his community, Paul's family, were controlling the finance, controlling the financial things of that time. They were very rich, commercial controllers. And not only that, he was an influential man. He had a very big name among Jews, and he was a member of Sanhedrin. No ordinary people won't get that position. So Paul was such a great man with all the wealth and all the positions and all kinds of comfortable and influence. You know, even the high priests were also on his side. And then he says he was a born Roman citizen. See, Roman citizen, getting Roman citizenship is not an easy thing. A person who's having Roman citizenship, ordinary police cannot arrest them. They enjoy special privilege. So Paul, the servant of God, had all these special privileges. What he says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. See, look at how Paul is entering through the straight gate. All things that were gained to him. See, the shipping business was a gainful thing. And being a member of Sanhedrin was a high position. And having a citizenship of Rome is an important thing. But before entering through the straight gate, he has forsaken all. Therefore, he says, but what things for him, and the power of resurrection, and the fellowship of suffering, being made comfortable unto his death. See, what is his lose? What Paul is running for? I may know him more. I may know him more. And know the power of resurrection. See, what do you mean the power of resurrection? You know, when Jesus Christ has breathed his last, then his body was brought by Joseph and he was buried in a new tomb, and a big stone was rolled at the mouth of the tomb. Then the scribes and Pharisees went to Roman governor Pilate and said, when this man was alive, he said, he will rise again on the third day. So we don't believe that, but his disciple may come and take away that body, and then later on they'll say he rose again. Then it's going to be very troublesome for us. Therefore, make sure that the tomb is well secured. You know, the tomb of Jesus Christ, there's a big stone kept at the mouth of the tomb, and on the tomb there was imperial seal of Roman government that says this tomb belongs to the Roman government. And then soldiers were guarding on the tomb. You know, soldiers are there not for to pay the respect, but I praise and thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. On the day he rose again from the dead, what he did, he came down from the earth, because he went down to the earth to deliver the saints, the souls of the saints. And then when he came, he saw the soldiers guarding over it, and the Roman imperial seal is there. What he did, he just entered into that tomb, into his body, which was persecuted, which was tormented. What happened? Earth realized the Creator has come. Immediately, the stone that was kept was rolled away. There is a great earthquake, and the soldiers fell dead. And Jesus came alive. You know, this Paul, he was a Saul. He was a persecutor of the body of Christ. He used to go to the houses and persecute people. He did that in many places. He was very strong in his conviction. He thought that what the religion they are following is the right one. What Jesus was preaching and disciples of Jesus preaching, he thought that's the wrong one. So he thought, he was convinced in his conscience, in his mind, that I should destroy this religion. Therefore, he got special authority to go to Damascus. On the way to Damascus, he was on his horse with his people. A shining light came upon him, a shining ray of light. This great man fell down. This great man who was working against the way of God, working against Jesus Christ, he saw a great light shining on him, blaring on him. And that man fell down. Then he understood, yes, there is something stronger than Jewish nation. There is something stronger than Sanhedrin. There is something stronger than the King Herod. There is something stronger than Roman Pilate governor. There is something stronger than the Emperor of Rome. I want that. And that is Jesus Christ. Therefore, he says, I want to know him. For that, what he did, he has counted everything lost. For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, so that I may know him. He saw Stephen, because he was a witness. People used to keep the cloth. When people start throwing stone at and kill a person, there must be a witness there. And that witness should say, yes, I saw this man was committing that sin. So I am a witness. So therefore people bring, they keep their clothes, because you said he did this mistake. So we are going to throw stones at him. So Paul, at that time his name was Saul, he stood there. Yes, I know this Stephen preached blasphemous things. He's preached against God, I know. So let, if he's not doing that mistake, if that he has not committed that mistake, let that sin come upon him. That's why the witnesses say. So he stood there, and people be used to bring their clothes and say, oh Saul, because you say, we are going to throw him stone on him and kill him. And he saw the stones were being thrown at Stephen. This man was not crying, don't throw stones at me. What is it? I see the Son of God standing. He did not accuse them. And finally he said, forgive them. Then Saul understood, yes, this is something wonderful. This is something stronger than what I followed so far. Therefore he said, so that I may know him. And then the power of his resurrection. And then fellowship of his suffering. You know, he saw the people. He was going around and arresting all the believers of Christ and throwing them into the prison. Some of them were being stoned to death. Some of them were beaten. But yet they were rejoicing. Then he understood, there is a joy in this suffering. There is a joy in this fellowship of suffering. Therefore he wanted to know that, the fellowship of suffering. That's why Paul choose the path of narrow. That's why he entered through the straight gate. Preacher, man, the great man who conduct big healing crusade. Can you say, according to the word of God, that you entered through the straight gate? If not, today, when you hear this word, submit yourself and enter through the straight gate. Can you say that you are walking through the narrow path? Narrow path means you'll get wounded always. There'll be something that hurt you. It is not always pleasant. It is always pain. There'll be painful things. People will be telling things against you. Incidents may come. That's why Paul, the painful thing, let us see what are all the painful things of Paul. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we read the painful things Paul went through. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I read from verse 23 onwards. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 onwards. Are they ministers of Christ? Speak as a fool. I am more, in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths often. Of the Jews 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned, thrice I was suffered shipwreck. A night and day I have been in the deep, in journeying often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of mine own countrymen, in perils by the brethren, by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among the false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fasting often, in cold and nakedness, beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all churches. Friend, Paul walked through that narrow road, narrow way. My friend, I want to tell you, by the grace of God, I entered through the straight gate. You know, I praise God, I thank God with all fear. I want to share a little bit of my testimony. I was a captain in the Indian Army, in the Corps of Engineers. I was really interested in bridge designs and all other engineering things. And I was young. And there's every possibility to become a big man in the army. But when Jesus Christ called me for the ministry, I left everything. When I submitted my resignation, Government of India, the armed forces, they wanted to give me some promotion. They turned down my resignation. Second time I applied, then also they turned it down. Third time, being a commissioned officer, permanent commissioned officer, regular commissioned officer, I had to apply for the President of India's interview. And the President of India deputed three lieutenant generals to interview me. And they interviewed and they said, I don't want anything. The government said, if you wait for 2.5 years, you'll get a good pension, a good amount of pension. I said, no, I cannot wait anymore. Then they said, you wait 7 months, you'll get some gratuity. I said, no, I cannot wait even a day more. You know, I came out of the army with an empty pocket. And I chose this path with my family. I suffered many things. Experienced hunger many times. Even my children, there were times they cried for food for 2 days, 3 days, no food at all. I had the experience of eating leaves, wild leaves, for continuously for 7 days when we were working in Rajouri. My friend, I chose this path because I saw Jesus. I saw the way of Jesus. I saw the path of Jesus. The narrow way and the straight gate will lead to eternal life. And even now, I am not, though I am preaching the word of God for the last 30, 40 years, so many people offered me many things, mansions and so many things. I did not accept it. I'm still a pilgrim. I don't have a house of my own. I don't own even an inch of land on this earth. I decided myself that I will continue as a pilgrim. I will continue to walk through this narrow way. Now also, I am living in a rented house. This being recorded from a rented house, I continue this way because I know this is the way. I do not want my flesh to take credit of anything. I do not want my flesh to enjoy anything. My dear friend, this is the way. I call you. Take your decision. Make your mind to follow the way. When you follow this, take this way, narrow way and straight gate, your flesh is under control. So the other component of the yoke of Jesus Christ is choosing the narrow way and the straight gate. My dear friend, will you submit yourself to choose the straight gate and narrow way? I pray that God may open your understanding so that you may choose the... Father, I thank you for the word that you've given us today. Lord, help my friends to choose the narrow way and the straight gate. Help them to enter through the straight gate, a narrow way, so that their flesh is controlled and they may take the yoke of Christ upon them. Help them to follow this path. Thank you, Lord. Let this word continue to teach them. In Jesus' most holy name.